The thing that I'm going to go through the talk reasonably quickly because it's about an hour talk that we're cutting down to half an hour, but I'll be around afterwards, so if there's anything I skip over, feel free to come up and talk to me. Just before we start, I want to acknowledge the Aboriginal owners of the land on which we meet and pay respect to the elders past and present, and also the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people here today. So first, a little bit of background about me. So I'm a contemporary artist based in Canberra. I graduated from university in 2013, the ANU School of Art, and I've been a practicing artist for the last 3 years, exhibiting fairly widely, mostly in Canberra, also a little bit in Sydney, Melbourne, Tasmania, one or two overseas as well, both solo shows and group shows. I'm a disability advocate as well, particularly around accessibility to the arts for people with disability. So I've been working with a lot of the festivals in Canberra to increase their accessibility. A lot of my exhibitions have things like braille, audio description, sign interpretation, all those levels of accessibility, not just physical accessibility. And I've just started working with the National Portrait Gallery to kind of step up their accessibility. I also play wheelchair rugby for the New South Wales Gladiators, a little bit on the side, and I've just started a full-time job as a public servant to try and balance that stuff out, and we're seeing how that goes. So as a background on me as well, my injury, I'm a C6 incomplete quadriplegic. So I have reduced hand function, reduced leg function, reduced sensation. I had my accident back in 2009, fell off a 10-story building, third-story balcony, 10 meters, broke my neck, spent the next 6 months in spinal unit, all the kind of same things. I was in my third year at art school when I had my accident. I was quite a physical guy, circus, sports, that kind of stuff. I was a DJ out in nightclubs as well, and just kind of a fairly general self-destructive 21-year-old. So for an example, on the left, in the black, that's me, one of my last circus performances, maybe 2 months before my accident, and that's balancing 4 chairs on my face. And then on the right was 2 weeks after my accident, so that just gives you a comparison. A few quick examples of the work I made before my accident. Wasn't really sure where I was. I was at art school, still trying to find some stuff out. So I did a lot of stuff with the body and identity, and you'll see how that's reflected in my later work. So this was a kind of a series that really shows where my work went in the future, even before my injury, looking at how people are changed and shaped by like society around them. So after my accident, I had to make the decision, getting back out of hospital, doing a whole year of physio after returning to Canberra, I made the decision whether I went back to art school and followed art as a passion, or if I went somewhere else focused on my physio, or if I tried to find a job that would be more suitable for somebody in a wheelchair. So I made the decision to stop physio after a year. I was happy with where I was, even though I probably could have progressed further, and to focus wholly on my art practice. So that was a really big, important decision for me. I ended up graduating, like I said, in 2013, and living the poor art life for kind of the next 3 years after that. So this is an example of the very first work I made when I returned to art school. So we had I had a really influential teacher from Prague when I got back, and the first thing she asked me to do was to make a work that was the core of my art practice. What did I want to do? What did I want to be as an artist? Try to make one work that represented that. So this was the next big decision I had to make. I had to decide whether my disability was going to be part of my art practice. Would that then take over my art practice? How was that going to affect? There was always this kind of to and fro in the past that you were either a disabled artist or you were a professional artist. You were one of the two. There was never a crossover. So I made the decision that I was going to include my disability. It was part of my life. I shot myself. It was going to affect everything. But there was always this small distance between my disability and me that was part of it, but it wasn't the whole structure. So this work was just a very trying to simply sum that up, as well as the fact that I can actually stand up out of my wheelchair. I'm incomplete. I just can't really go anywhere once I stand up. And that breaking of expectation was going to be another thing that I looked at in my art practice, that idea that people see a wheelchair, they just expect you can't stand up. And using that fact that I can stand up and separate from myself from my chair. So what I'm going to focus on in this talk is kind of some key things to what you've got, the questions you have to ask yourself if you're going to pursue art as a career. And this can really translate to any passion, creative or otherwise. I think these are like key points you need to ask yourself and consider when you're going after that one thing you want to do in your life or the thing that you've been considering that you haven't done yet. So I'll show a couple of my artworks in relation to this as well. So they're who, what, why, where, when, and how. So who? So who are you as an artist? I think that's really important to decide. We get really like tied up in what is art and trying to define it and what, who's where and what space we fit in. And I think you really need to define the space you fit in as an artist. Are you a contemporary artist? Are you a commercial artist? What kind of art are you trying to make? All those kinds of things. How you define yourself is really important. So knowing who you are as an artist or as a person is really, really important when then you're then talking to other people or putting your art into a space, because it gives you a frame of reference to really reflect on your art. And then I think what a lot of people miss, who is your audience? Who's looking at your art? What type of people are looking at your art? Who do you want to see your art? And how are they going to relate to it? How is what you're making translating to those people that have an experience outside of your own? So this is my third year body of artwork. It's called Accessible, and it was about my place in public space as a person with a disability. So they're a little hard to see with this little bit smaller, but if you look right in close there, you can see me on one side of the image and my wheelchair on the other, and then all the figures moving through it are a little bit blurred. So it's about that fact that disability is really kind of structured in public space, and public space really defines the way we move through public space as people with disabilities, whereas other people can kind of transition through these spaces more anonymously. This was a performance artwork that I did at a small gallery in Canberra, a little pop-up exhibition. It was based off of quite a famous work by Marima Abramovic called The Artist is Present, and it was called The Artist is Disabled. So this again was playing with that idea of what we expect from disability and the position we place people with disabilities in. So I started in the gallery before people were let in, standing facing my wheelchair, and people were invited to sit in my wheelchair, and I would just stare them down in that position. And I stood for as long as I could until I collapsed within the gallery space. So it switched that position of power, that all of a sudden they were lower than me and I was staring them down. And also they, talking to people after, they felt that they were taking my place or taking my chair and almost forcing me to stand up in that space. And I was also very interested in the power dynamic. Would people stop me from falling? Would they try to catch me? Did they want to take that away from me, like that agency, or would they let me possibly injure myself for the sake of my art or knowing my own body? So that one was quite interesting, I thought. Okay, so what? What are you making? What are your medium? What are your themes? What are your concepts? All really key things to kind of define in your own practice. And a lot of artists do this in their art school years. A lot of disabled artists don't get the opportunity to go to art school, so it can be really hard to figure this out. But I think they're extremely important questions to ask yourself, whether it's just, okay, I'm a photographer, or I'm a conceptual artist, or I'm working on disability, or I'm working on youth. So this was my honors work, and some of the work you can see up the back that I've got on display, called Fluxability. So I was interested in, this is a really conceptual work that I did a lot of research into, in this idea of the other and the norm and how we transition through phases of ability. So it was about the disabled, and the super abled. So in each of the images, I'm in there three times, once in my wheelchair, once looking able-bod, and then once in an exoskeleton I built. And people would come up to these, they're really mundane images, just think it's just an everyday thing, and all of a sudden realize I'm in there three times. And because they have this whole idea of disability being static or our positions in the world being very static, all of a sudden when I was standing in an exoskeleton, standing on my own and then in a wheelchair, they couldn't decide whether I was disabled or not. All of a sudden they couldn't position me. And that was supposed to translate the audience into questioning, okay, what do I understand about disability? Maybe these things aren't static. Maybe I need to question my own perceptions. Why? So why are you making work is another really important one. Are you just making it as a living? Are you doing it for yourself? Is it just an important thing for you? Are you pursuing social change? Are you trying to be a really heavily conceptual artist and you're playing with ideas and that kind of stuff? Or is it a personal outlet? One of my favorite sayings from an artist, and this is a little bit offensive, so I hope I know anyone, but it's a lot of artists get in trouble with like just making work all about them and like it's all important to me, and then I just throw it out in the world and they can deal with it how it is. And this teacher I had said, it's okay to masturbate, it can actually be really healthy, but don't jerk off into a canvas and then ask me to love you for it. So it's kind of understand what you're doing with your art, why you're doing it, and then accept the relationship you build with the audience. So with that, my work, some of it's quite personal, it's about me, but I'm always considering the audience, I'm always considering the social impact it will have. And I've started extending that out beyond just disability. So this series, I looked at all groups of the other. So I looked at Indigenous groups, different genders, sexes, different races, people with different disabilities. And I looked at the very offensive language that we all know we're not supposed to say, and then the very subtle questions that people in these groups get asked. And I got them to wear t-shirts. I worked with the individuals to work up these text on their shirts. So it all came from their experience. And I got them to wear t-shirts with those on them and place them on opposite sides of the gallery to create an open space for people to actually discuss these ideas. Because I think another big thing is we never actually talk about this stuff. It's like, oh no, you're just not supposed to say that. Or we have a defined thing, what's okay and what's not okay. And if we don't discuss it, then things don't ever change. So if, for example, it's for my one, my t-shirt says cripple, no, we're not supposed to say that. And then the I'm not sick is the response to the question I get a lot, which is, oh, will you ever get better? And my thing is, I'm not sick, I'm not getting better, it's not about getting better. And then, you know, I've got my friend, she's in a long-term relationship, and whenever she's in a relationship, she's a lesbian, she gets asked, okay, well, who's the man? And she's like, there is no man, that's kind of the whole point. That's the whole point of our relationship, there's no man. So I was interested in this guy. And this was also done in, that was in a community space. So it was in a community gallery in a community center. So I was, again, thinking of the audience, who was going to be there, who was going to interact. All those people were from the local community. So it's understanding your space. I might just, unfortunately, skip over this work really quickly because it's quite a long video. I'll see if I can just show a quick section of it. So this is, I worked with a couple of guys from the rugby team. And it's called the Rugby Creed. It's based on the Rifleman's Creed that you might have seen in like Full Metal Jacket and stuff. This is my rifle. There are many like it. This one is mine. But it's about our relationship to our wheelchairs, specifically our rugby wheelchairs, because they're such an integral part of how we kind of interact with the world. And these four characters go through and say this creed, and they say it to you and respond to you. And it's about that relationship of, these aren't limiting devices, they're empowering devices, and this is our relationship with the devices. All right, where are you showing your work as well is also really important. So are you just showing it at home, are you showing it in a bar, are you showing it on the internet, are you showing it in like a gallery, is that a gallery, a community gallery, a commercial gallery, a public gallery? I see people trying to do really like high art stuff and then show it in a bar where there's just a lot of drunk people wandering around, and then they wonder why no one gets it or no one wants to spend the time sitting and looking at it. So understanding your relationship to your work and where you're showing your work is also really important in kind of moving forwards with your career. So this was one of my most recent works, and this is a work that I made where I really pushed the accessibility of the exhibitioning practice as well. And I was taking also in the work that idea of how we relate to the image and how we understand people through images, trying to push that to the next level where it's not just about disability or other groups, but anyone, how images build our understanding of people. So it was an experimental work. I printed it on clear plastic vinyl, so the photos don't show up great, but clear plastic vinyl, all life size, and I manipulated the physical ink on the surface of the material so it actually dripped and melted. So the idea was that you had to actually acknowledge that these are photos. They're coming from a perspective. They're an interpretation of an individual. They're not the actual individual. When often we have this thing about photography being true and this relationship of a one-to-one. So we see something, we go, oh, that's that type of people, that's what they are. Especially in disability, there's this long history of the disabled image and the way it's been used for like charity and pity and freak show. And it's really hard to escape that image and then people placing that image on people they meet in reality, because that's how we interact with people. So again, trying to break down those assumptions of when you first engage with someone, you may have a preconceived idea, but allowing space for that to evolve is really important. And the bottom two photos there you can see is just some of the accessibility stuff. So I had Braille, audio descriptions. You could physically touch the work and feel the image, the outline, all those kind of things. I had a sign interpreter there. And it was actually quite interesting. I've been pushing really hard for accessibility arts, not just for people with disabilities, but the amount of able-bodied people that come up and get really excited when they can touch an artwork or when they can hear an audio description, the way other people interpret an artwork, actually adds a lot to a work. And I managed to get tons of people from, like, because Canberra's got all the major national institutions, but they hardly do any of this kind of stuff. And I managed to get some of them at least to come and see the stuff there. So hopefully that's going to kind of flow on a little bit into the space. Also, people just think there's no audience for it, which is kind of crazy because they're like, oh, well, no one asks and no one comes. I'm like, they're not coming because you haven't done anything. So it's kind of like this weird catch-22 where it never really happens. And that's just one of the works from it. So the back wall was me melting three times. So these are physical prints. I haven't digitally manipulated these or anything. I printed them, hung them up on the wall, and they melted like along the surface. When? So when do you make your work? This is a really important one, I think, for a lot of people when they're pursuing arts or they're pursuing their passion. The amount of times they hear people just say they don't have time for their work, or they don't know when they can fit it in, or they don't have time to do the thing they love, is kind of crazy. So I mean, if it's your hobby, if it's not necessarily your passion, you don't want it to be like your entire life, that's fine, fit it in when you can, do it on the weekend, do little bits here and there, take a holiday and do a little bit extra. But if it's something you really want to do, even if you're working another job to like support yourself, you need to consider it your profession. You need to consider it your job and spend time doing that work. If you don't have time, ask yourself why. Is it really something you want to do? Or is there something else getting in your way? And how can you get around that thing to get in your way? The amount of time I spend writing grants, writing applications, just researching ideas or looking at other artwork just to fuel my practice is huge. That last body of work you saw, I had to spend a month writing a grant to fund that work because I wasn't going to be able to afford it on my own without knowing whether I would get that grant or not. I just had to do it and hope for the best and then plan for what would happen if I didn't, plan for what would happen if I did. I went up to Sydney and Melbourne to shoot people. I had to put the gallery, I developed the process, I had to work with printers, I had to work with tons of different groups. And all that's this big planning stage where people just kind of often think, oh, I can sit in my isolation and just kind of make the work. And you can't. You really need to start treating it like a profession. And then as that moves forwards, it will transition into a profession. If you're acting that way, people will see it and people will reflect on it. So I've started getting offers from galleries coming to me, asking me to do work for specific events, for specific shows. They've come saying, we can give you funding now. So I'm not making money as an artist, but I'm not losing money anymore, which is a massive thing. There's not a lot of people that can say that. So this was for an iDay event at the Belcott and Arts Centre. Temporary work, they gave me some money to make it. I just had an idea and kind of ran with it. They trusted me. But it's because I had built that professional practice that they trusted me, they had faith, and they went, yes, we can put some money into this guy and he's going to produce a work. Another work as well. I enter competitions, I enter exhibitions. Sometimes it's just to give myself a deadline. If I know I have to enter a show or a competition, I'll make work. And then I'll want to make it good because I know someone's going to look at it. And to end up, how? How do you make work? So this is really dependent on you. This is dependent on your physical abilities, on your training, your learning, all that kind of stuff. You need to go out and find out what tools you need to be able to do your work what help you need to be able to do your work. I use assistants in the studio constantly. Every one of my friends has helped me at some stage or another. Other artists have helped me. I've dragged them along all the time. Sometimes I pay people if I really need to, that's fine. As a photographer, I use a tripod, I use timed shutter releases. I spent a lot of my time in the early days working, if I'm gonna photograph myself, how do I do that? What's the easiest way to do that? What do I need to practice so I can do that in a public space? So working out all those kind of different things. What do you need to do to get the funding to support your work? Can you find someone to back it up? Is there special funding for disability that you can go after or any category you're in? Is there community funding? So there's all kind of research stuff that you need to chase down to go, how is the best way for me to be able to achieve my goals and do my work? And if you have any questions about some of the really like nitty gritty stuff in relation to that, come up and let me know and I'll kind of go with it. So as an example of that, this is one of my earlier works where I was wanting to make something about my time in hospital and my disability and my relationship. And I didn't have any photos from back then. I didn't have anything around it. So I went and sourced material relating to my disability and went, well, this is a topic I want to make work about. If I can't do it the exact way I want to, what's a way I can get around that to build on that concept using my abilities and stuff like that? And this one's really outside of it. Sometimes you just got to make work for fun. So this is kind of like a little fun work I made for a pop-up exhibition. It was really fun collecting all this stuff. So that's a Twinkie. It's like an American cake with like sugar and preservatives and cream inside a little box with, there's about 12 live cockroaches in the box as well. And it was on an exhibition called The End of the World, and it was about, there's these two online myths that cockroaches will survive a nuclear war and so will Twinkies because they've got so many preservatives. So I wanted to put them together and see which one would survive. And as a note, the cockroaches will die before they eat the Twinkie. They refuse to eat the Twinkies. So just, I thought that was quite interesting. But again, it was, I had this idea, I wanted to see it through. And rather than just going, oh, that's crazy, I can't do that, I went and found out where I could get cockroaches. I went and found out where I could get a Twinkie. I found someone who could make me a box and I put it all together. And that ended up, I did that for fun and it ended up getting shown down in Melbourne for the Climate Change Art Festival at the oldest commercial gallery in Australia. So by just doing like these things and making work, you can sometimes it just ends up into the right space. I was going to show this little video at the end, which is my favorite work that I've made, but unfortunately we're run out of time. So we'll move on to questions and maybe I can play that quickly as people are packing up or something at the end. So yeah, that's pretty much everything from me in a nutshell. Is there any questions that anyone has? No? It could be about anything. It could be about something I said. It could be about something I didn't say. Could be something to do with my practice, do something to do with me. Or I can show that artwork.
Hi, Daniel.
Hi.
Could you, I'm just interested in who your influences are now and other artists with disability, and I guess a comment on, is that a relevant point?
Sorry, what was the first part?
Just influences?
Oh, influences. So a lot of my influences come from outside of disability art, from kind of a general aesthetic and conceptual point of view. So I look at a lot of performance artists because they do a lot of work with the body. So there is some translation between the body and then working with the body and disability. There's a lot of conceptual disability theory that's not directly related to art, but it's kind of moving into that space, and it's based off feminist theory and queer theory. So it comes from that certain sort of space. I mean, where we are now with disability art is about where feminist and queer art was maybe 20 years ago, something like that. So there is pockets of stuff coming up in the disability art space, but because for so long it's been treated purely as rehabilitation or inclusion, it hasn't been treated as like a high art form. It's like, oh, you make disability art, okay, you're over here. It's been very tricky to get into that space. I've been very lucky that I was at art school before my accident, so I was already in that space. I had a lot of connections, I knew a lot of people. So I kind of just transitioned straight into that space. Looking in the States, there's some good stuff going on with disability theory, because that comes, disability art, because it comes out of the disability theory space. And then in the UK as well. They've got a really strong advocacy movement as far as disability is concerned, and that's translated into a really strong arts movement, especially after the Paralympics in 2012. Like, they got a ton of funding to make a big arts festival, and then they realized that everyone actually loved it and they made some great work, and they've done it every year since. And it was just having that one moment where they actually got the funding to go, yeah, yeah, we can do good stuff if you give us a chance, that they kind of went, yeah, cool, we'll just keep going with all the funding and all the pushing it forwards. So if you wanted a very specific curator, I would say Amanda Kashia in the States, C-A-C-H-I-A. She's doing some really interesting stuff with exhibitioning and working with different artists. And then if you look at the Unlimited Festival in the UK, they're the main disability arts festival in the UK, and they're linked to tons of artists. In Australia, yeah, we're really separate. We've got some strong disability arts organizations that do mostly advocacy and have started funding a lot of stuff. The Australia Council's only just put in a disability arts funding program. And last year I was on like the first big disability arts residency in Australia, and that was connected to the Australian Network of Arts Technology down in Adelaide and the UK Unlimited Festival. And they brought over 6 disabled artists from the UK, 6 from Australia, because they knew we needed that relationship to start building it. Up until this point, if you're a disabled artist in Australia, you go to the UK, because there's just nothing here. You leave and you don't come back, because that's where the funding is, unfortunately. But it's now, if we can keep this building, those people will come back, because they want to come back. It's just if there's a space for them there. Anything else?
Any more questions, guys?
You can always come up to me one-on-one afterwards if you want.
Okay, awesome. Thanks so much, Daniel, for sharing your experiences and your art with us. And thank you guys for coming.
Let's start playing.